University, and I study biophysics, specifically organismal biophysics. So how do animals perceive the world around them, and how do they use that information to do really cool and awesome stuff? So today I'm going to talk to you guys about electroreception, but before we get into that, we need to talk a little bit about electricity. So there are three fundamental properties of electricity that we really need to understand before we can head on further. First is electricity itself as a phenomenon. The second is potential difference. And the third is electric fields. So what exactly is electricity? It might sound like a silly question, but I asked this to someone in my cohort, and they said, I don't know, magic. So electricity is any time you have a charge moving from one spot to the other. So usually that comes in the form of free electrons. So say I have a free electron here, and it wanders its way to the other side of the stage. That would be electricity. Now the question we should all be asking ourselves is, why would an electron want to wander from here to over there? So I usually like to think of this the same way I think about water flowing. So if we have a river, and it starts up high in the mountains, and it's moving all the way down to the sea, why is that water moving from here to there? Well, it's because there is a difference in energy. You have a lot of potential energy here at the top of the mountain and a little down here, and the water wants to move from high to low. Same thing for electricity. You have a circuit, and one side of the circuit has a whole lot of charge built up on one side. That's going to have a different energy than the other side of the circuit, and the electrons want to move from high to low energy through the circuit. So the last phenomenon we need to think about is electric fields. Electric fields, I think you can think about a lot as a spider web. So if you have a charge, a point charge, it's going to have a way of interacting with the world around it. And if another charge comes and interacts with that spider web is going to somehow repel, say if you have an electron, away from it, or if it's a proton, so a positive charge, pull it in close. And that's also going to affect the original point source. So we have electricity, we have potential differences, and we have electric fields. I think we all are used to thinking about electricity in terms of circuits, but there are actually a lot of examples of electricity happening naturally in nature. The first that usually comes to mind for people is lightning. Lightning happens because there's a huge charge buildup between the clouds and the ground. You get a lot of buildup of charge in the clouds, there's no charge buildup on the ground, and all of a sudden, bam, you get a release of that energy flowing from high to low. Electricity. Another example of electricity in nature, a lot of us are probably really used to interacting with, is static electricity. So if I'm standing on a carpet and I rub my feet, rub, 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 I pick up a bunch of spare electrons on my body. And I know where to go because I'm not a closed circuit until I touch the doorknob. So I have a bigger charge difference than the doorknob. I touch it, all those electrons flow out of my body to the doorknob, and I shock myself and it hurt. So another form of electricity in nature. Yes, I know memes. Another form of electricity in nature that I don't think really clicked for me until I was in college is actually the electricity of the body. So we can't really dig too deep into this until we start to think about what really happens when your body is trying to send a signal to your brain. So I hit my elbow on something, and I hit my funny bone, and it hurts really bad. What's happening? Well, a neuron, actually what it does is when it's just chilling out, it takes ions and pumps them out of the cell. What is an ion? An ion is an atom that has an extra charge. So we have, for example, salt, and we break it up into its ions. We have sodium, which is positively charged, and chlorine, which is negatively charged. So let's focus on chlorine because it's negative, and we've been talking about electrons. So let's say we have a neuron, and it's chilling out, it's hanging out, it's going to take all those chlorine atoms and pump them out of the cell. It'll use energy to pump it all out. All of a sudden, we have a buildup of charge between the inside and outside of the cell. As soon as you hit your elbow, your neuron's going to open a bunch of ion channels, let all of those ions back into the cell. That's charge is moving. That's electricity. And that's going to continue to propagate all the way up the body until you hit the brain. But what's really important to think about here is that means in its resting state, your neurons have an electric field built up because of that charge difference. And in fact, any living being has an electric field surrounding its body. In order to be alive, you have an electric field. And it turns out there are a lot of animals that have learned to take advantage of that. So you're a shark. You're out in the dark of night hunting. It's too dark for you to see. and you're rumbling around, sniffing along the sand, and you can't smell anything because the fish have found a way to disguise their scent from you. And you're moving your head across the sand, all of a sudden you feel a tickle in your nose. Because you're sharp, you know that tickle means that there is a fish there. And snap, you've eaten the fish. What just happened? Electroreception. Sharks and rays and eels, all elasmobranchs, which is a subspecies of fish, have an ability to sense electric fields using gel-filled pores in their nose. So when they move their head around and they sense another animal, it's going to trigger those electric pores, and they'll be able to find them and eat them. This is called passive electroreception, when you sense something else's electric field. But there are also types of active electroreception. So for example, the elephant fish here in the center picture has an organ in its tail that produces an electric field, and that goes out to the environment around it and conveys information to the fish about what its environment looks like, much like echolocation in the bat. Also, there's one mammal that has the ability to do passive electroreception, the platypus, because the platypus needed more reasons to be weird. Now, this building is thought to be limited to marine organisms because water is conductive. That means that you can sense something else's electric field. That electric field is going to permeate really far through the media. And if you send out an electric field, it'll go really far and come really far back. But recently, 10 years ago, electroreception was discovered in one terrestrial animal, one animal that lives on the land. The bee. I know this is a dead bee, but I still thought it was fun. So before we talk about how the bee is electroreceptive, we have to talk about what the electric field looks like on the surface of the Earth. There is a global atmospheric electric circuit that exists between the surface of the Earth and the ionosphere. It increases at a rate of 100 volts per meter. That means there's a charge difference between my feet and the top of my head that is about 150 volts. That's I am not a circuit, so I have built up 150 volts as I go up. It's actually the same phenomenon that creates lightning. I won't get into that too deep. But what's really interesting is that plants are conductive, and they are grounded. They have roots, they go into the ground. So any trees, flowers, bushes don't have the same sort of charge difference between the top of their head and their feet as I do. Because they're grounded, the bottoms of their feet are the exact same voltage as the top of their head. So if we have a 2 meter tall tree, the top of that tree is going to have a 200 volt difference between the top of its head and the air around it, a charge difference, which creates an electric field. And some animals use that electric field to learn things. So the bee flies around and becomes positively charged. We don't know why, it just does. It flies around and becomes positive. Now, a flower, a plant that's grounded, is going to have an electric charge compared to the air around it. The bee flies in close to it, and all of a sudden, the hairs on its body start wiggling in a specific way, and that lends it information about the electric field of that plant. So, just to recap one more time, we have a global electric circuit. It increases as you go up. That means plants are going to have a different voltage than the air around them. Bees fly around, they get close to it, and they can sense that electric field. Why are they doing that? We're not 100% sure. It's possible they're using it to gain information about whether or not a flower has been recently visited. So if a positively charged bee comes and lands on a flower and then leaves, that flower is going to have a different looking electric field than a flower that hasn't been visited recently. Maybe it's somehow conveying information about the amount of nectar that flower has. We don't know. But what I am interested in learning is whether or not this ability is limited to just bees. So a lot of the hypothesis for why bees are electroreceptive are because they're pollinators. If that's true, we would expect to see this ability in other pollinators. So I am working with the hawk moth, which is a species of pollinator moths that are indigenous to North Carolina. They fly around usually at night, and they're really good at pollinating flowers. So if, for example, we knew that electroreception in terrestrial animals originated from the most common recent ancestor and then ended up in all of the other pollinator insects, we'd call that homologous evolution. But if it existed in only bees, or if it exists in hawk moths but in a different form, we would call that convergent evolution. So the most recent common ancestor of all pollinators did not have this ability, and it evolved independently in different pollinators because there was some sort of pressure by nature for that to happen. So how do we figure out if an animal is electroreceptive? Well, we can't walk up and ask it. So what I do is because I have two types of fake flowers. They're both metal. One's held at 0 volts, one's held at 30 volts. And I say, all right, Mom, the one that has 30 volts in it has flour. And if I can train it, the one that's 30 volts has food in it. And if I train it over and over again to continue to come in here and see, okay, the 30 volt flour has food in it. And it learns repeatedly to always visit the 30 volt flour. I take all the food out of it, I put the moth back in, and it still goes straight to the 30 volt flour. Then I know it actually has the ability to see that electric flow.